Let me open it for questions. We have about 25 minutes, I'm told, and I need some lights out there so I can see hands someplace. Okay, so let's start here. Please say who you are briefly, and if you have a question to direct to a particular person, do so, or to the panel as a whole.
Thank you. I'm Meir Shitrit from Israel.
I'd
like to raise the question of debt, which
j'aimerais parler de la dette que M. Soukic a abordé. Le fait est que les taux d'intérêt sont très bas.
To invest their money or even take loans in order to buy stock market because it's going up. What is your expectation on the future of the stock markets? Because I'm afraid that if it falls, it's not only falling of the stocks, but it will be fall of the big debt and create a big crisis even bigger than 2008. I would like to know what you think about it.
Okay, let me collect several questions and then we'll turn to the panel. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much. I've got two quick questions. First to Kamal Dervish. His comments reminded me, I think, back to the solo paradox of the late 1980s, when it was argued that there are computers everywhere, but it's not being reflected in productivity. And I'm wondering if there's an analogy you'd be drawn there, and also you, Professor Cooper, because I remember reading and using a lot of the work you did on stagnant wages, which also started during that same period. So I'm just wondering if there's not, you know, an analogy to be drawn from what we experienced then, what we're experiencing now. I don't know, so I'm just asking a question. The second one is the question of these trade deficits and protectionism in the United States. President Trump and his team, seem to focus almost exclusively on currency manipulation and so on. Now, is this fair? I mean, you've got a $356 billion deficit, I think, with China. These numbers, I think there are about four major ones that jump out: Germany, China, Japan, I think Mexico, but South Korea thereafter, and Canada, who are actually lower. But I'm wondering, is this correct? Should they not be focusing more on American consumption habits, on investment? Because it seems exclusively at that level to be focused on currency manipulation and unfair trade practices.
Let's collect a couple more. Yes, there.
I'm Damage, a researcher from Central Bank of Morocco.
La Banque Centrale du Maroc.
I would like to thank you for the quality of your presentation. I have a remark from the fiscal monitor of the IMF, which is inequality. We learned from this last edition that if inequality declined between countries, it was widening within countries. And here, I want to ask you, do you share the recommendation to enhance the tax progressivity? And also, if you can recommend this proposition of enhancing investment in education and health, because it's an ex-ante treatment, and there is also taxation, which is an ex-post treatment. Thank you.
Que les inégalités entre les classes ne soient pas en fait creusées davantage. Merci.
Thank you very much. Tatsuo Masa from NUCB Business School in Japan. I have a question to probably former Minister Kemal Dervish. Hearing all these great stories and together with current fashionable talk about industry fourth industrial revolution,
on parle
I fear de la social divide or economic divide. Companies and individuals who can ride on all these quick changes can take advantage of those. But companies and individuals who are left behind
could have no chance of getting fruit of this. Le capital,
the result could be social or economic divide within community, within the country, within the region.
Le bien de l'économie
nationale, how do you foresee the risks
au profit de qui, au profit des citoyens? Comment garantir en fait
cet équilibre? Okay, let me turn to the panel and ask for solicit responses, and then I'll go back to the audience. Kamal, a few were addressed to you. Why don't we start with you?
Totally agree, and in fact, that was one of the key points, I think, of my quick presentation. that inequality is a major, major issue.
And pays,
the past trends, which have made intra-societies very unequal, although between countries, because of the growth of developing countries, global inequality may not have increased, as maybe even decreased. Inequality inside the countries is increasing everywhere. And one of the reasons that I tried to, it's not the only reason, but one of the reasons is that those who are doing well are doing better. And those who are not doing so well are doing less well even than before. So today it matters a lot in which firm you work. Education also matters, of course, and health systems and so on. But there is a concentration of power and wealth and productivity growth in a small number of firms, many of them global firms, whereas a lot of other firms are being left behind in the dust.
Ceux qui ont bénéficié sont essentiellement les grands groupes, les multinationales.
This will create social problems. PMI, I think of a major magnitude which we are seeing happening all over the world.
Donc,
so I think that inequalities side of the equation in looking at the world economy has to be underlined very strongly. Now the question on asset prices, because of the low wage growth, low inflation, I don't see any major push towards any rapid kind of normalization of monetary policy. So, I mean, I think asset prices may perhaps have overshot, but I don't see a major, you know, collapse of asset prices in the global economy. I think income distribution and the social consequences of income distribution is a much more serious problem than the asset price problem.
Sinon, la situation
and
va perdurer.
I do congratulate the IMF for having taken on this problem.
Ici,
you know, in the old days, it was just
a
footnote, maybe, in an IMF report. But today, the IMF is actually addressing this issue as a major
monde,
overall macroeconomic issue, which gives me some hope that, that policies will be addressed. One final thing, I think it is in line with President Macron's policy also. You have to attack the problem before transfers and taxes. Transfers and taxes can correct things, but if the primary distribution is very unequal, it's very difficult to make it more equal with transfers and taxes. So the real issues are competition, entry, small enterprise, access to credit, education, health coverage, and things of that sort. Taxes and transfers are important, but if you don't solve these problems, you will not be successful in reducing inequality.
Thank you. Others want to comment? Murray? Merci, Murray.
Just some follow-up, obviously, Kamal and I agree on these, issues, particularly on the inequality question. Just a couple of kind of elaborations. One is the wage stagnation is very important when coupled with inequality, but there's a big difference between advanced and developing countries. The developing countries that are growing fast are seeing wages rise, even as inequality gets worse, so at least people feel, even the people who are losing out, so to speak, in relative terms, are gaining in absolute terms. And that's very, very important for social cohesion. The problem in the United States, particularly in the United States, but it's also true in other countries, is that you have a combination of wage stagnation and wage declines for some parts of the population, like white men, at the same time as you have rising inequality. So that's very important. The second is on education.
Yes,
of course, I believe in the importance of education. Education as a cure for inequality, we have to be very careful. Because it depends where the money for the education goes.
All right?
In the United States, There's a superb educational system, but in many respects it's also been a deséquilibrizing.
Aux États-Unis, il y a
des inégalités flagrantes concernant les chances
d'éducation offertes aux Américains.
Et
l'arrivée du président Trump n'a fait parfois que aggraver ces inégalités. C'est vrai, il faudrait
One point also quickly on asset prices, Mr. Schiffer.
Historically, you know,
a big adjustment in the stock market by itself has not actually induced, you know, typically has not resulted. We've had many examples of very large adjustments in the stock price,
which have had relatively minimal effects
on the real economy. I agree with Kemal that the adjustment to date has been gradual. If you see inflation pick up
in the course of about a year from now or so,
then I think we should be worrying more. Final point is, insofar as a lot of the stock market purchasing is by private institutions,
people can take risks,
even individuals,
who can take risks. There's only so much that they'll allow you to borrow margin,
for example, I can tell you from personal experience.
Then I think the effect is less.
It's when you have very highly leveraged institutions like the banks that are taking all sorts of risks, which could include the stock market, but typically doesn't, that you can get a major financial
cataclysm.
I have a comment about the relationship between technology and development. Someone just mentioned Solow's paradox, where we can't see any of the result of the technological advantage to the macroeconomic growth. But if you
la stagnation
did, for example, study by Robert Gordon, it just shows there's some kind of increase of the productivity, say, between, say, 1990 to 2000.
Global.
So there was some kind of effect on productivity. Maybe technological development is not strong
aussi,
enough. We just have a continuous technical development.
Pas,
and another very important area, as I already mentioned, very serious, big timeline between the timing of technological introduction and the result of economic activity, because industrial structures have to respond to absorb the result of technological progress. Now, just remember, major technological development we often discuss today, like a deep learning of AI, or just expansion of Internet of Things, this happened in the last maybe 5 years. So we have to be very patient to just wait for the result of the technology to be reflected in the economy. And also, I just want to make a very brief comment on the bilateral trade deficit surplus with the United States in exchange. I have to just comment, this is not the first time. Japan just suffered a lot of this discussion in the 1980s and 1990s. So when the trade issue became very serious, the United States is always just mentioned trade deficit and exchange rate. And of course, this is very dangerous, but at the same time, we have to be very patient to negotiate and discuss the issue. So I think the trade issue is very important, but this is, I'm not just very pessimistic at this moment.
Mais néanmoins, nous restons optimistes concernant les perspectives à venir.
Faire un commentaire sur le dernier point. Peut-être que ce n'est pas véridique, que c'est quelque chose qu'il faudra tester, mais je ne pense pas que le nouveau président Trump soit un protectionniste. Pour des raisons que je trouve assez bizarres, il est contre les pays en fait qui ont des grands surplus avec les États-Unis.
Germany,
la Chine,
Canada has even been added to the list, Mexico,
Canada,
and so forth.
Le Mexique,
but I don't think he's intrinsically protectionist. There are two ways to eliminate a bilateral surplus, which is the wrong policy to focus on.
il faut éliminer certaines politiques. L'une, c'est de restreindre les imports et d'augmenter les exports. Et je pense qu'il serait heureux avec les deux, peut-être donc surtout l'augmentation des exports. Il a nommé certaines personnes qui sont, eux, des protectionnistes. Mais je considère cela comme étant un grand point d'interrogation au niveau de l'administration Trump, à savoir s'il est vraiment protectionniste ou pas. Il a parlé de ça, il a fait allusion au protectionnisme, mais il n'a entrepris aucune action.
In the renegotiation of NAFTA,
et même dans
the guidelines
lors des négociations de la NAFTA, les lignes directrices qui ont été publiées, vous vous souvenez, c'est un accord de 25 ans. Les lignes directrices étaient raisonnables.
From much of the TPP
elles étaient tirées en fait des négociations TPP.
I've been around long enough to know that with trade negotiations,
je travaille assez longtemps dans ce domaine pour savoir que les négociations commerciales ne sont jamais finalisées jusqu'à la fin vraiment. Mais il faudra voir ce qui va ressortir de ces négociations. Mais c'est certainement une source d'incertitude.
Is very different from previous
et le ton est certainement très différent so des anciennes administrations américaines, ce qui est une source de préoccupation. Mais moi, je ne dirais pas qu'il est vraiment protectionniste et qu'il veut mener le monde dans la voie du protectionnisme. Mais je voulais poser une question par rapport aux taux d'intérêt qui sont très faibles, ce qui me rappelle Stanley Fish in July. Fait par Stanley Fischer au mois de juillet, c'était un discours qui portait sur les taux d'intérêt faibles.
Identify the reason behind the low interest rate. I recall he mentioned a couple of things. First of all, is the aging population.
Population becomes older,
which will create a demand very soft. That's first. Second is technology advance also creates some income inequality.
I can recall the one figure.
When Facebook got IPO, the market value equivalent to GM, but Facebook only hired 7,000 employees, while GM hired 250,000 workers. You can see the asset concentrated on small people. That's also created some low demand. Here, I want to add one factor. Not many people mention, because I recall before the global financial crisis, one term be used frequently, so-called great moderation. That means that time growth rate very fine, is good in advanced country, also low inflation rate. The one of reason behind that is at the end of 70 of last century, China started to take open door policy. 10 years India take that. Also that time Soviet Union collapsed. Almost 2 billion people get more or less get into global integration, which great demand for advanced countries. Now these dividends have been dramatically reduced or disappeared. I guess that's the very important factor. Then I answer the question regarding the trade deficit. I guess the trade deficit of U.S., the reason is very complicated. But one factor we don't forget, U.S. had a trade deficit with 100 countries, not only with China, with Germany. Yes, China and Germany occupy large share, but the U.S. have a trade deficit with 100, more than 100 countries.
So,
yes, I don't deny there's some room for U.S. negotiate some deal with some country, which can reduce the deficit. But another factor is we understand
saving and investment. The difference between saving and investment equals the difference between export and the import. That means the saving rate in the U.S. relative to investment is very low. That means the investment needed in the U.S. in some way creates trade deficit. That's something I guess we should look at liberal comprehensively, not only focus trade deficit.
C'est pour ça qu'il ne faut pas se concentrer seulement sur le déficit commercial. C'est en tout cas ce que je pense.
Sorry, Mr. Young. Yeah.
Monsieur Young.
I'd like to add one more comment.
J'aimerais juste ajouter un autre commentaire sur le déficit commercial avec la Corée du Sud.
The key word is the aging population. So we conducted an empirical study about the reasons why many economies enjoy the trade surpluses. And we examine the relationship between the surplus and the population aging. So the two variables have very strong and positive relations.
The
Korean society is experiencing very, very rapid aging problems these days.
I think
in 10 or 20 years, maybe Korean economy will suffer from kind of a trade deficit because of the aging issues.
I'd like to make one further comment about the trade issue. It's another identity. Drew our attention to the identity between trade surplus or deficit and excess savings over investment. Another identity is that for every trade deficit, I'm using trade in a comprehensive way, including services, there's a capital account surplus.
Un surplus de capital.
And you think about that for a minute.
Et si on pense à cela,
if we want to reduce the U.S. trade deficit significantly, which Trump says he does,
Trump
it means also reducing the U.S. capital
account
surplus,
by an equivalent amount apart from measurement errors.
And that means less
équivalent.
Foreign investment
cela
in the United States.
Y aura moins d'investissements
the U.S. has
aux
an enormous amount of
les,
foreign investment in the U.S. net. Some of it goes into U.S. corporate bonds and U.S. government bonds. A lot of it goes into equities, including the very companies we've been talking about,
dans les capitaux,
Facebook, Google, and so forth. And one way of putting it, which economists have not absorbed yet, in my judgment, is that the U.S. has a comparative advantage in producing new firms. And the new firms are, if they succeed, of course many of them don't, but if they succeed, they're attractive around the world, not just in the United States. And as long as this process continues, there's going to be a net capital inflow into the United States, and with a floating exchange rate, ergo, trade deficit. Now, I don't know if any of Trump's advisors have pointed out to him that eliminating the trade deficit means eliminating the net capital inflow into the United States. We have enough time for one question. I see from the clock up there.
Anyone?
Way back there.
For Yuri and
for Yuri,
I'm a little puzzled by your...
Identify yourself, please, Jeff.
Yes, Dick. Jeff Frieden from Harvard.
Jeff Frieden de Harvard.
For Yuri and Kamal, I'm a little puzzled
pour
by
Kamal,
your view on
un peu
the debt issue.
Par,
it seems to me that the question
sur la question
is not whether nominal interest rates are low. It's what the relationship is between the growth in debt and asset prices. The fact that interest rates are low is irrelevant to the asset liability mix. The fact that interest rates are low, in fact, que les taux d'intérêt soient bas, ça veut dire que les banques centrales ont perdu pas mal de
Second question for Kamal. I'm a little confused about your notion that we should focus as a policy variable on pre-tax transfer income distribution. That's a 40-year process. Reversing it is probably a 20-year process. It seems to me that if the problem is income distribution, saying that what we should focus on is pre-tax pre-transfer is a formula for not being able to do anything in the short and medium
term. L'exemption fiscale, etc., ne va pas mener très loin à court terme.
I do believe it is very important to focus on the pre-tax and transfer distribution issues and what creates it. For example, monopolies are an issue here. Pre-tax, pre-transfer. If you put all the burden of correcting the maldistribution of income or the very unequal income distribution on taxes and transfers, you run tremendous political problems and also inefficiencies in the whole system of taxes and transfers. So I do believe that real wage growth, competition, productivity growth that is much wider, more widely shared, these are things that will create a healthier income distribution. I'm not saying one shouldn't work on taxes and transfers, but I don't think one should put the whole burden of it on taxes and transfers. And I think this is really a very crucial point, because in Europe, for example, you already have 50-55% of GDP worth of expenditures by the government. I mean, how can you reach 70%? Without creating major inefficiencies. On the other hand, if you democratize the production process and allow small firms to do well, allow easier entry, put barrier to monopoly profits and monopolies, you can do all these things with much more an efficiency characteristic to it than via just taxes and transfers. The other question, I don't know, I'm worried. Do you want to answer them?
I'm not sure I understood it, honestly. Can you repeat the question, Jeff?
No, sorry. We're going to have a discussion over dinner. Jeff can clarify his question. I'm going to bring this session to a close, and just remain free, I hope, on behalf of all of you, to thank our panelists very much for a very interesting conversation.